the council please come to order? And our first order of business is salute to the flag. Please raise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Roll call, please. What's the matter with this? Oh, here.
Too loud. Note for the record that all council members are present except Councilmember Conway, who will not be joining us this evening.
Thank you. Adoption of the agenda.
So moved.
Do we need to make some changes to the agenda, Mr. Mayor? I talked to you earlier.
Yeah, you did. Would you remind me what they were?
Yes, yes. I'd like to move their San Mateo County Tourism Business Improvement item number M to the beginning of the agenda, because I know the rest of the items are going to be rather lengthy, and I don't want to keep the people who are here to go through all the discussions that it's going to take place. So I'd like to move
that is item
number M of the consent calendar.
Okay.
And maybe bring it before the presentation, if I can.
How long is this going to take, Chair?
This item M, should not take any more than a couple of minutes.
Any objections to that?
No.
Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay. Item M then will lead off the consent calendar. Okay, adoption presentation. Oh, you want to put it before presentation?
Yes,
right?
Yes.
I'm sorry. Before presentation.
Yes.
All right. We have with that change, do we have an adoption of the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? No. All right. Item M.
Does the staff want to talk about this, or you want me to give a background? No problem. As you know, some of us have been working on this for a long, long time, and trying to get our hotels to be part of the San Mateo County Visitors Convention Bureau so we can have traffic there to have visitors. We have a good thing going in our area, but it's not being noticed. And we couldn't be successful without the cooperation from the hotels. And I'm blessed to say that with the management changeover and the work that they have done, I'm honored to say that today this is becoming a reality. We have pretty much the blessings of San Mateo County Visitors Bureau and the hotels. And I just want to say that I'm honored to see Anne LeClaire here. She's doing a magnificent job. And I'd like to, if you don't mind, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to ask both of them, Brian, general manager from Radisson Hotel, and Anne LeClaire, to both come forward and talk about what does this take and what we are trying to accomplish. And it's a very, very special day for some of you that might not realize how important this is.
Thank you, Councilmember Richardson. Thank you, Mr. Mayor, all of you. We are very thrilled to have Brisbane and Brisbane's properties at long last interested in participating with us. Once Brisbane comes on board, we'll represent everyone from Brisbane down through Palo Alto, with the exception of Menlo Park. And you'll be able to take advantage of the things like the trade shows that we do, the outreach for familiarization tours for not only meeting planners, but international travel agents. So the timing is great. And we're thrilled to know that our partners are interested.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Brian, would you like to say a few words? And what does this mean to your hotel and or the community? Or?
Well, I appreciate your time and your efforts on this. We're excited we took over the property back in May. And one of the things we noticed as we built our marketing plan and we built our budgets, et cetera, was looking at our vehicles to where we could, you know, get revenue from. And one of the things we were kind of amazed about is that we were not involved in the San Mateo CVB. Upon talking with Ann, getting involved in dialogue with them, we realized that there's a window of leads, a window of good synergy that we're missing out on. So our goal really is just to become part of their organization and have an opportunity to be an active player within the organization and just represent Brisbane in that capacity.
Thank you. And I know that you have made quite a number of changes at the hotel, particularly at the restaurant and the events that you planned there. I think it's, would you like to talk about that?
Sure. Some of the things we're real excited about is some of the product upgrades. We've put new mattresses in. When I was a young hotelier, a person told me that I'm in the mattress business. And I said, what do you mean? He goes, to make it worse, you're in the used mattress business. So I thought he was quite funny. But we also have just put in flat screen TVs, 42 inches. So we're real excited about that in our rooms. And by and large, the biggest change to the property has just been an overall philosophy of hospitality and bringing back kind of the cheers, you know, everybody knows your name scenario to our guests as they come in and out of the hotel. As you said, in the restaurant, at one point we had leased that out, and we no longer do that. We now run the restaurant under our hotel management, and kind of felt as if that if you were a guest at our hotel and you went to eat in that restaurant, you didn't look at it as two different entities. You looked at it as the Radisson Hotel. Now it definitely is. So, you know, we stand behind everything that goes in our rooms, in our restaurant, and we're excited about what 2011 has to bring to us in Brisbane.
Thank you. I think the improvements that you have made, the work that you've done at the Radisson Hotel, it's remarkable. I've gone to eat over there. I think our community members should support our local businesses and definitely go to the restaurant. You would see the changes and the atmosphere. You feel like home. It's really great. And after we're done, I think you would really benefit from knowing Mr. Lee Panza, our former mayor, because I remember he was one of the few people that first talked to me about San Mateo Convention Visitors Bureau and our hotels. So later on, make sure you get to know him.
I hope to do that. Thank you.
Thank you. So with that, I'd like to make a motion to approve item number M.
Which is resolution number 2011-09, correct?
Yes.
Be second.
And we have a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. Congratulations.
Okay. Next order of business is presentations. And this is where the Lions Club comes in. Thank you, folks, for coming.
Thank you. Thank you.
Good evening, Mayor. President of the Brisbane Lions Club, Ernie. On behalf of the district, C4C, and the Brisbane Lions Club, like with district, Governor Mike Solem, the second vice, Bob Wilson, and a few of our members here, Brisbane Lions Club Secretary Margaret, Treasurer Lee, membership didn't show up there, and Tail Twister, Larry Pruitt. On behalf of the Lions Club, we'd like to present the American flag to the city of Brisbane for the Mission Blue Center.
All right.
Great job.
Mayor, here's the flag that's being presented to this city for the use at Mission Blue. It'll fit in there. Here we go. Yeah, it's got to come this way a little bit. There we go.
Okay.
Thank you.
As of the, from the Lions Club, from the district to Lions Club to the city, I'm going to do the
Thank you.
Okay.
And Governor, I'd like to say a few words.
Mayor, City Council, staff, my name is Mike Simonini. I'm the District Governor for 4C4. We are fortunate enough to be able to use the Mission Blue Center on occasions. And as far as we are concerned, it is one of the finest centers on the peninsula. You have everything that's needed, parking, beautiful facility, and it's great, and we thank you.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
I'd like to take a moment to address my former colleagues and you too, Cliff.
Thank you.
Just to say a word about what this Lions Club organization is all about. As you probably don't realize, one of the principles of the International Association is the promotion of good citizenship. And I'm sure you don't realize, except for Lion Sai, that it was our club that donated the flagpole that stands in the park. This donation now is another extension of that promotion of citizenship that we're all about. We're proud to be members of this community. As you probably realize, some of the members of this organization are some of the most active members of the community. So it's nice to be able to partner with the city on events and the use of the facilities. And this is our way of giving back.
So, Lee, how do you get to have all those pins?
Thank you very much. And
he's bulletproof.
Thank you.
I am indeed very proud to be part of that organization myself. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thanks for all the great work you guys do.
Great job. Thank you.
Thanks, Walt.
Okay. The next presentation we have is Bert Ganon, Manager, Aircraft Noise Abatement, San Francisco International Airport. Welcome to Brisbane.
May I give a little background, if you don't mind?
Please, thank you.
We have had quite a number of concerns from the citizens that airport noise have increased unmeasurably, disturbingly, and unbelievably. And this increased noise, most of us have seen it increased ever since Virgin Airlines have started flying over central Brisbane, seeing United and all kinds of stuff. A number of you sent email and making calls and so forth. I brought up the attention, I brought this situation to the attention at the round table. And generally, the answers that we would get is, we haven't changed the procedure, we haven't changed any of our routes, it's just weather condition, it's safety, all kinds of things. And here, 4 or 5 years later, it's just gotten worse, terribly worse. So I'm honored to say that if you want to know anybody that knows his stuff and hopefully can do something about things, is this gentleman that is standing before us. Bert Ganong is the director of the San Francisco Airport Noise, and I know his concern is truly to be able to make a difference and to accommodate both the business and the communities that we share the airspace truly in our communities. When we brought up this complaint, he agreed to, and you have never done this, to have three additional noise monitors in such a small space in our community. He immediately brought three noise monitors, and I asked input from people where they want to have it. Suggestion was to put one at Mission Blue, one at San Bruno, end of San Bruno, and one on Kings Road, because these were the hot spots that we got a lot of calls. And they did. They collected the noise. We've been working with Bert, with San Francisco Airport Director. We've been working with media. A lot of you have been active in making phone calls. The media has gotten involved, and they have agreed to come before us and share their findings with us and working with us how they can make a difference in our community. So with that, I'd like to welcome you and thank you very much for tonight.
Thank you for your
time.
Thank
you, Bert.
Thank you, sir. Please proceed.
Council members,
Well, just to cover the analysis that we did, we identified and analyzed departure procedures that are the primary concern from San Francisco Airport. It's the port departure, and I'll show an image in a moment and illustrate these. The quiet, the offshore, the shoreline, and the Eugene. Oakland International Airport does contribute as well with the Skyline Coast and Nuevo departures. We analyzed operations from San Francisco going back as far as 2000, just to be sure that we could give a fair cut of the information to everybody and show what was going on. We analyzed the airlines and aircraft type changes over the years as well, and we measured the noise at four locations in Brisbane from October 28th through November 18th. We analyzed the historical noise and flight tracks from 2000 through 2010 as well. This not-to-scale image is representative of the general flight routes in and out of the Bay Area. On a good day, what we call West Flow, San Francisco Airport depicted in the slightly left of middle with the dark purple and light purple. The routes that we're talking about with the port and offshore are depicted by this left turn off of the north-facing runway called Runway 1. Another one that is not depicted here that we've been attacking heavily is the shoreline and quiet departures, which make a right turn from Runway 28, the westerly-facing runway. When executed properly, it can be a good noise abatement procedure for the area. Wanted to show the overflight interactions based on the previous image that we talked about. The red at the top are the San Francisco arrivals, roughly between 9 and 11,000, but the bulk of them is between 10 and 11,000 feet. Those are coming from the northwest, headed to the northeast to go down the bay to arrive on runway 28 right. The middle traffic is mostly the Oakland Skyline departures. And the lower departures here, which turn left and go over the city from the bay, are the San Francisco ports and the Eugenes. The reason we show this is to let you know that it is thick. It's three layers thick. And so this is an onion that we're unpeeling here and trying to make everything work right, and also keep things working right as far as the FAA and the National Airspace System goes, and get the cooperation from everybody involved. The slide you see before you shows our operations from January 1999 through October 2010. As you can see here, we were up in the 400,000 annual operation area, and then come 9/11, well, actually the first drop-off was our dot-com implosion. 9/11 is the steepest, you can see here. We also have United's bankruptcy, the SARS, sudden acute respiratory syndrome. And so we dropped down from 1,200, 1,300 operations a day down to 650 a day on our lower days. Right now we're up about 1,000 a day on a big day. So what we're trying to say with this is we're not back where we were as far as our operational counts go. We are coming back as far as numbers, and I'll explain more about that in just a moment. The resurgence we can sort of point at in the early 2008, late 2007 with arrival of Virgin America, JetBlue deciding to compete head-to-head with them, and Southwest coming back. Southwest had gone away for a while, and they decided to come back and make a go of it. This has contributed to the influx of operations that we've had. As you mentioned earlier, and we've been investigating with and trying to see if we can get better cooperation from them as well in their comeback. The other contribution we've had is the international carriers are coming back too. The business and business travel and the economy is coming back on a lower scale, but we're seeing that, which is a good thing in a way for our economy. It's nice to see that. And the other one we've had is migration of traffic away from San Jose and Oakland airports to compete here at SFO with these new carriers. We do believe that as traffic reaches a point, as it did before, they'll go back out to the other airports, just a natural migration.
Excuse me, Bert, would you put the microphone closer to your...
Sure, thank be happy you. To, sorry about that.
No problem.
Sorry, I'm trying to keep it away from my sniffles. I did want to show the next slide, which we're looking at passengers. We're looking at international and domestic stacked. You can again see the drop-off in 2001, September the 11th. But what I wanted to show here is the number of passengers. And actually, in October of this year, we did have our highest October in quite some time. The resurgence of the passenger numbers is good. It means the airlines are using the airplanes more efficiently. They're filling them and not running airplanes every hour on the hour to say they did it, which is good. 99, 2000, we did have that. Now we're looking at efficient operations, which is better. Our airline operations and fleets, what we looked at, well, we do have new carriers operating on the same old routes. United is remaining, though, in lesser numbers than they were before. The new carriers at SFO have spurred operations, as I mentioned earlier, with JetBlue and Virgin America and Southwest. But they're bringing newer and quieter aircraft, which is good. The primary aircraft on these routes are narrow-body aircraft. We're looking at the Airbus A319, 320, which are very quiet aircraft in general. The noisier ones of the bunch are the 737, 300, and 500, but the 737, 700, 800, and 900 series are considered to be the quieter ones with the newer engines, newer quieting that they've improved on the airframe, which makes it quite a bit better. And then the 757, 200, which is a good size airplane, but it's relatively quiet and does have a good noise signature for us. Noise monitoring. Well, as you mentioned earlier, Councilmember Richardson, we did have quite a few monitors in a small area. We wanted to make sure we had an overlap within a half a mile of each other to be sure we had good coverage. The constant is our Site 7 at the Margaret Tank location. We did put one at the 300 block of Kings Road just to be sure that we were able to validate that site and give just a bit of a slight elevation difference, and it was able to hold its own with Site 7, which is good. Two Solano and 475 Mission Blue, so the pool and the meeting rooms. Just to show you on the map, we had roughly the half mile overlay with Site 7, two Solano and 475 Mission Blue. The 300 block of Kings Road was just below Site 7, and actually quite close to our old site that we had on Kings Road in the past, which is where this information comes from that I'm showing you right now. The old Kings Road location we had for our previous Site 7, 1999 through 2006, before it was removed, the aircraft noise was as high as 55 decibels when averaged over a one-year time period. CNELs, community noise equivalent level, means averaged over a one-year time period. So you're taking the good and the bad with that. And as you can see, 2001, we had the drop, and then it just continued to drop off as far as the aircraft noise. And we went down about 43 decibels, 44 decibels. Whereas the community noise levels from the surroundings, it did continue to grow. In looking at 2009 through 2010 with the new Site 7 up at the Margaret Tank site location, we're looking at aircraft noise, both SFO and combined aircraft, the blue being all aircraft, SFO being the red, picking up in the 45 decibel range, and we've bumped up as high as the 55 for a bit, keeping relatively low. And when averaged out over the time period, it does come down to about a 50 decibel, sorry. During the monitoring that we did in 2010, October, November timeframe, we're looking at the numbers here with, for the entire time frame, the Margaret Tank location, aircraft and SFO aircraft are about 50, 51 decibels. We looked at the 300 block of Kings Road, it's the same. We look at 2 Solano, it dropped off a little bit. And then 475 Mission Blue, being further north, it dropped off even further. If People have asked why. Well, it's fairly simple. The bulk of the traffic is in this area, and then further out is over there, and also they're higher by the time they get further north. Well, the airlines, I analyzed the data. We came up with three airlines that came to the forefront for the number of operations and the noise levels they were making for us. The departure procedure routes have not changed. The aircraft noise levels in the city of Brisbane actually declined. Went down by 10 decibels, and then we've come up by 8 decibels. So we're down by 2 decibels over our high in 99-2000. And the aircraft on the established departure procedures were quieter in 2010 than they were in 2000. The top three airlines contributing to our noise for this monitoring period were Southwest, United, and Virgin America, in that order. The number of flights captured at the Margaret Tank location for Southwest, 265, 288 for the Kings Road, 323 for Solano, and then 202 at the 475 mission.
This was the 2 weeks period.
That's the 3 week, actually.
3 weeks, 265 from Southwest. Mm-hmm. 191 United.
Mm-hmm.
And Virgin, 170 in this small community. Thanks.
Correct. So we're talking about the number of noise events for each airline at the sites here with the bar graphs that you see at the bottom. Out of this study, we came up with some action items. And what we're looking at is obviously the here and now, and we're also looking into the future. So we're looking at working with the top 10 airlines, which we're doing right now. We're getting good results and good feedback from the airlines. We're also working with air traffic control to remedy some of the issues we notice with them and their adherence to their noise policies that they have for the peninsula and the city. And we're following closely the individual airline changes and providing feedback to them quickly. So as we get from them some information on what they're trying to do to make a change, we're giving them feedback quickly so that they know it's worthwhile. Excuse me. We're trying to assist the Airport Community Roundtable. I have a bottle over there. Thank you. Appreciate it. Trying to assist the Airport Community Roundtable in a rapid propagation of their Fly Quiet Noise video. It was recently approved for production and distribution by the Roundtable. And with that, we believe we'll be able to get the message out much faster to the airlines on an easier to understand message. The communities will also be receiving this and be able to view it and play it under the local community channels so that they can see what we're putting out to the airlines and to the community so they can have a better understanding of what's going on. We're going to work closely with the stakeholders working on the next generation of air traffic control departures and arrivals to the Bay Area. They're looking at a 6-month study looking at the Bay Area Metroplex as a whole coming up for the new RNP, Required Navigational Performance, and RNAV, Area Navigation Arrivals and Departures. They're going to be redesigning our airspace. And so we will be going there, talking to them, FAA and the stakeholders, letting them know that there are concerns with what we have and possibly with what they come up with. So we'll be working that as well. Wanted to show what we've gleaned in December for noise levels here. The community is in the red, total is in the green, and the aircraft CNELs, and this is all aircraft, by the way, for Site 7 in December, in the blue. We see some real drop-offs here. Those are days where we were reverse course and we were using runway 19, so we didn't overfly the city. So we should have had some very happy people on those days. And looking at January, we've actually had a fairly quiet month. We're averaging about 50.2. Aircraft CNEL, less than the 51 that we monitored at, which is good. So we're actually making it a little bit quieter incrementally. We're looking at the altitudes and elevations of the aircraft as they fly over the city to see if we can get some better information out of that. And then I do have one other PowerPoint that I'd like to show you. This is courtesy of United Airlines. United Airlines gave this one to us immediately. When I contacted them following, actually it was before our meeting, but they gave it to us just after our meeting. they are actually playing this in their crew briefing lounge for the pilots on the television monitors around so that they can see exactly what we have going on. So it takes just a moment for this to load up.
So while she's loading it up,
yes,
and there is another thing that we've been able to do is you've arranged to have 10 people, two groups from Brisbane to go to San Francisco Control Tower and have a meeting with the air traffic controllers and get an understanding of why we are where we are.
Yes.
And if there are three staff is going to be going and seven from community members, I'm working with the staff to select those seven people. And those names we have gotten from the noise calls that you have made and personal contacts with myself or the city. So you would be getting a call. And there are criteria that FAA uses that for security, we need to have it all cleared beforehand and so forth. So you're going to get a call or email from Maria. Thank you.
Thank you.
Go ahead.
What they've done with this PowerPoint is basically they're playing this on the monitors in the crew briefing lounge for the pilots to see. It lets them know firsthand that there is a noise issue here. We were attacking the, it's known as the shoreline departure here. Those in the green are actually good departures. The pinks are what we call marginals, and these reds that go quite wide sometimes are actually poor. And you can see right here, United basically tells the pilots that we have been identified as a major noise contributor to the communities.
So next time when you bring awards to United, I know what to tell them.
Well, they know. And so we're working with them on this. They are using some of our graphics to do this, as you saw with the green, pink, and red. What they're doing with this one, we developed a Jeppesen 10-4 page quite a while ago, and Jeppesen is a major briefing distributor for air navigation charts. 10-4 page is where they contain noise information for the airlines to brief their pilots, and they basically tell the pilots, look, use this. Use it well. Stay away from this area. Stay on the green track. You'll do well.
So this is what you're doing with United?
United has already done this. It's playing in the briefing lounge.
Would you tell me what are you doing with Virgin?
Virgin America, we've worked with them. They're actually looking at what they can do with Northern California Tracon for a power reduction. The problem with that is if they reduce the power too much, it's going to affect the rate they go through the area, and the air traffic controllers. I'm working with Patty right now to see if we can get what they have planned put in effect, and they'll be using that. So by doing that, they'll be able to come through the area quieter and a little bit slower, but we don't want to mess up the national air traffic system by having them do this. We want to have it done right.
Okay, so you keep saying that no change in pattern or route has occurred. Virgin was not here before 2009.
Correct.
Nobody was flying the way Virgin comes through the hills.
I would argue with you on that one for saying that it was Delta, Northwest, whomever before.
Okay.
It's a new carrier, same route.
Okay.
Let's get through with the presentation, then we'll...
Go ahead.
That concludes my presentation.
Okay, thank you, sir. I have a question. We do hear aircraft going over, no question, I'm sure
yes,
you agree.
Yes, won't argue with you there.
Once in a while you hear one roaring through, he sounds like he's trying to land. Now, what is the problem there?
Well, to use a recent example, January 4th, we had a Boeing 747 come over the Mount San Bruno. I call those rude flights because you don't hear them coming.
No.
The flights that come over the bay, you can kind of hear them coming. You get all tensed up about it, you know it's there. The flight that comes blasting over the hill on a poor shoreline or a quiet departure swung wide are the ones that we're really trying to nip in the bud right away, because those are the ones that sound like they're going to land on your house, frankly. We analyzed that one. We talked with the airline to figure out exactly what happened. We listened to the audio tapes from the tower. And we figured out that it was a Cathay Pacific Boeing 747-400 going to Hong Kong. The flight had filed for the San Francisco 8 departure, which would, to use the image on the screen right now, go either straight out or straight out. But after 10 o'clock, the tower has an agreement with Oakland Center that they will call them up and say, okay, no more San Francisco 8s. We'll be using the quiet. The reason for that is the Oakland Hills straight across the bay receive our flights all day long. There was an agreement made many, many, many years ago that we would no longer overfly them after 10 o'clock, that we would direct the flights up the bay using what's called the quiet departure. The quiet departure is sort of a misnomer, in my opinion, because it hugs the San Francisco shoreline. I believe it was a remnant from Alameda Naval Air Station being open. Well, it's closed. Let's see if we can get those out in the middle of the bay a bit more, because the Oakland flights come over and join them as well. I've never liked it. With the Bay Area redesign of airspace, we're going to be working on what's called RNAV departures, or area navigation departures, or performance-based navigation using GPS, much more precise. We'll be able to get them following a good route, something that they can repeat every time. The disappointment for some with a very precise navigation route is if you're under that, and instead of being fanned out, everybody's all of a sudden over you. Could be a very contentious issue. And that's one thing I'm very cognizant of as far as the newer navigation procedures coming out. I've been working with many groups developing these, trying to understand how they're having issues with other airports who've done some early adoption of them. We're looking at how we're adopting them and seeing that we don't make mistakes like that going into the future.
Thank you. Council, anyone questions?
No.
I do have one more.
Yes, ma'am.
I had a notice that Virgin increasing flights, expanding, we know that. Toronto, I mean, they're just all over. And I'm very happy for them. It's one of the truly beautiful airlines that I used to travel. So I'm grateful. How's that going to impact Brisbane with the expansion of?
There's also an announcement in the paper they were going to be expanding their fleet. I don't know if you saw that one.
Yes.
They announced more of the Airbus aircraft,
right.
But they announced 30 of the what they call Neo A320s, which are the newer generation, quieter engines, less emissions, and what was the other one they had for it? One other benefit that's a plus to it as far as the environment, but it should be a plus for everybody involved with that.
So this fly quiet SFO show that you have it for at the lounge for the pilots for United, can that also be shown to Southwest pilots and also Virgin?
I'm not going to show them United's, no, but I'll try and get them to do something of their own just like it.
Okay, that would be great.
And showing it to them, yes, they may say, well, we won't do that, but we'll do this. So that's one of the things we try to do is you play an airline against another airline sometimes, and not in a bad way. This is a good way.
Of course. Okay, thank you.
Councilmember Lenz?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Do you have the lights on? Sherry?
Thank you for your presentation, Bert.
Thank you, sir.
You know, growing up in South San Francisco, where my mother lives on Ascanio Drive, the planes would go over her house multiple times every single day. I mean, it's so, and it's still that way. I mean, it was like that when I was a kid. It's that way today. The noise level is about as worse as, it's the worst, one of the worst types of flights over Brisbane, but she gets it every single day. I was recently in San Diego, and of course they have their flights coming in and out of this very densely populated area, but the sound level doesn't seem to be that intense in San Diego. So my question to you is, can the pilot have control over the amount of noise that is generated by a plane when it's going over a populated area?
To a point, yes. And I'm glad you brought up the San Diego. The difference with the gap departures, which the South San Francisco departures are known as, they go out through the San Bruno Gap. Many of those, especially late at night, are heavy, heavy aircraft going, 747s going to Asia and the like. The flights in San Diego are typically not a 747. They're smaller aircraft, not a heavy. So it's a lighter aircraft and easily able to be quieter.
And those are the ones that will go over Brisbane, correct? Similar types of aircraft?
Most of the narrow bodies, yes, yeah. Over Brisbane. As far as the pilot procedure, yes, you can do what's called a close-in noise abatement departure procedure. So you use as much power as you can for takeoff. Once you break free of the ground, climb as rapidly as possible over the airport. Once you reach 1,000 feet, you level over a little bit and pull some power out and go to a climb departure rather than a max performance takeoff. A lot of the airlines these days prefer to use something less than a maximum performance takeoff because it preserves the engine life and reduces their fuel burn. These days, every penny counts to them. So we've reiterated our counseling with the airlines as far as preferential runway use at night. We've reiterated our counseling with the airlines as far as the gap departure procedure for the San Bruno Gap folks. And we're really beating them up as far as the shoreline departure procedure goes. Now, the port, the offshore, we're working with the airlines on those as well, which affects directly Brisbane. And so we're getting some good feedback, and I believe we'll be able to show some more positive results coming very soon.
And what type of, I know everyone's counting pennies, but what type of dollar figure are we looking at? If you look at what they're doing today as far as the flight technique compared to if they use the same technique down in San Diego?
Well, in San Diego, they're using the same thing. They're using reduced power takeoffs, if at all possible.
But you said they try not to do that here because it costs extra money.
Both places. I'm sorry. Okay. My misunderstanding. Airlines worldwide, where they can, are trying to use reduced power takeoffs. It prolongs the engine life, and it reduces the fuel burn. To them, every penny counts, and that's the way they're doing it. Some airports around the world have been able to force the airlines to go to a max performance takeoff period.
That's right. So you said San Diego has that in place.
We've asked that they use that here.
Yes.
San Diego, somewhat. I know John Wayne does have that in effect. And it's calmed down from what it was. It was a very, very drastic departure procedure that they used to have there. And the FAA wouldn't issue that anymore to any other airports. They have had to modify their departure procedure. And also, too, the newer generation of aircraft have improved to the point where, in between, it's a safer departure procedure there at John Wayne. We're asking the airlines to do something like that, which is called a close-in noise abatement departure procedure, which San Diego also asks of their airlines.
Okay. And then in your report, you talked about how the routes have not changed.
Correct.
The reason why we have had the increase in noise is due to the pilots not staying on course to those.
They're actually staying on course. Since 2007, we've had an increase in traffic, and that's the belief is what we're noticing, is being noticed, is the increase in traffic since 2007.
Okay, so not the increase in noise per flight, but just the amount of flights.
Mm-hmm. Now, as I showed you with the good marginal and poor on the shoreline, there is a pilot technique there where you can actually do that departure procedure really well. We grade the airlines on that in our fly quiet departure procedure, and we do that on a quarterly basis. We've stepped that one up to make sure that we're on them a little more frequently, as in weekly, and we're working with the airlines to give them suggestions for improvement. We're having Emirates, who had some problems with it, come down to our office. They've already met with us twice. They have another meeting later this month where the actual pilot gets off his flight, takes a couple hours rest, and then comes to meet with us. And he goes back and gets the rest of his crew duty rest before heading out. So I'm really happy with the response we're getting from these airlines to be doing this with us. rather than just trading emails or a phone call here and there.
Sure.
For them to come in and meet with us for a foreign carrier like that, it means quite a bit. And for them to sit with us and listen to our monotony about a small local city that has a problem, that says a lot, that they're concerned about being a good neighbor. And that's what we're trying to get out of all of our airlines, is being a good neighbor.
Absolutely. You know, and that one graphic that you showed from United, mm-hmm. that one flight pattern, you had the different colors.
Yes.
If you fly, if you cut that right turn, and you do it correctly, mm-hmm. you have the green.
Correct.
The green color, and if you keep going towards the north before you make the cut, which would essentially go over Brisbane, mm-hmm. That's not a good flight plan to follow.
Yes, sir.
You know, a lot of complaints that I hear from the community is that the other flight pattern from, I think it's the port,
yes,
where you're go out towards the bay, mm-hmm. and you're supposed to head north and then cut across San Bruno Mountain and then head south towards Southern California, that they're making that turn too soon. And so instead of going over San Bruno Mountain, where there are no people or hardly that many people, you're going directly over Central Brisbane. Do you have that color diagram? Because, I mean, I would like to see that as well.
It's different on that departure procedure, mainly because air traffic controllers are vectoring those aircraft. So what they're doing is they're getting the departure. They'll turn left to the departure heading they're supposed to, which is 350, go north, and then when they either get as far out as 4 DME from the airport, 4 nautical miles, reach 1,600 feet, most of the airplanes these days have no problem doing that. They climb rather well and they perform rather well. So the controllers are actually turning them sometimes early as Oyster Point. So even before Mount San Bruno, you don't even see those nor hear those most of the time here in Brisbane.
It's not true. Certainly
too. Oh, all right. I'll be happy to sit with you on some of those. Okay.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, I mean, that's a major concern of the community is there's a lot of folks that feel that those planes are making that turn too soon, all in the effort to save money rather than trying to rather than addressing the concerns of the community.
Okay.
With the noise that those airplanes make.
Well, some of that doesn't always fall on the airlines. Some of that falls on the FAA, and I'm sorry for putting the FAA in the hot coals on this one. But if you look at the edicts for the FAA, it's a safe and efficient moving of aircraft from point to point. And in their edicts, they're supposed to quickly and efficiently move the aircraft through an area. And if an aircraft has the altitude, has the distance, they will oftentimes turn them onto course. And so that means that the pilot isn't doing it. He got an assignment from an air traffic controller to go ahead and execute your turn. We're working with everybody on this one. Like I said, air traffic control, the airlines, mm-hmm. everybody. We're actually stepping on some toes and getting little snips here and there from people. But I believe we do have a good, solid reason why we're doing what we're doing, and we're trying to make sure that we do it right.
Okay, so you feel that you're confident that through these negotiations that eventually the FAA will make adjustments so that a flight can be safe, but also not fly over the city of Brisbane.
We're working with them for everything we can get out of them. We always are, and we've stepped it up even more so lately. Yes, I will say that we are trying to get everything we can out of them. We've been able to get certain controllers during the night shift. We're doing what we call a runway 10 departure, which goes out towards the east. It's a preferred runway use at night. They would then turn them left over the bay, get them some altitude, and then turn them left over Mount San Bruno or the city of San Bruno to get them on their Pacific track. Well, they're not supposed to do that. They're supposed to actually go up between the peninsula and the North Bay, go out over the Golden Gate Bridge. Mm-hmm. And so we've caught them on a few of those and said, hey, do you mind talking to your people again? See if we can eliminate these. And they said, yes, we would. So we're holding them to their own noise abatement policies they have in their manuals. We're actually getting the cooperation from where we can on others. And we're going for everything we can in between.
All right. Thanks.
Mr. Mayor, may I also have a few more, if I just remembered. Bert, thank you very much. I appreciate the fact that John Martin himself has gotten involved in this.
Director Martin is always involved, as you all know, from the roundtable meetings.
But I'm really grateful that he's attended some of our meetings, mm-hmm. and he's involved with this. I'm very excited to see working with the FAA controller. There's a possibility that we would be meeting with Patty and John Martin to really go over this portion of what air traffic controllers can do to help us with this noise issue. The concern, and you know that, I wasn't happy when this report came out. Mm-hmm. Part of the reason is I hear what people are talking about. I work out of my residence. I hear this noise that is just truly, and my house is modern, noise is insulated, but I hear it very harshly. You had mentioned that flat roofs is also worse kind. We can pick it up even more.
Yes.
The bad thing about all your calculations, with all due respect, is the fact that you're looking at it at C and EL, the good and the bad. Mm-hmm. We're not complaining about the good. We're complaining about the bad. So when you complain, when you're dumping all the good and bad together, it's really skews the horrible 80 decibel sounds, 75, 65 sounds that we hear most of the time. You have a few good ones. Of course, they're going to make things mix. Is there any way that we can look at the noise at individual, at these, the bad ones, to really target those bad ones?
The single event you're talking about.
Exactly.
We can, yes. We do have the ability to give single event. In fact, it's all in the raw data that we have.
Okay.
The reason we use CNEL, as you probably remember from the roundtable, is that's what the federal government stipulates that we use, and the state. It's not that we want to use it specifically. That's what we're told to use.
Right.
And instead of going to different metrics here and there randomly for different projects, we usually stay with one so that everybody, it's a difficult thing to understand because it's logarithmic.
Yes.
And so we're talking 10 times every time it jumps. So it's difficult. So we try and keep people within one vein. I have no problem with, if you want to sit and talk single event noise, we can do that until the cows come home. We can work on that, see if we can find specific trends through that. Sure, I'm happy to.
I appreciate that. Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Sure. Thank you very much, sir. Appreciate you coming in. Well,
thank you, sir.
Mm-hmm.
Appreciate you having me.
And perhaps periodically we could get a report on how you guys are doing.
Yes, we've agreed to, I think it was 30-60-90. So we'll be meeting some more.
Yeah.
Good.
Johnny, were you?
And that we can share with the people, when you know.
Oh, definitely.
Sure. Thank you, sir.
If you'd like me to come back, I'll come back.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
Mr. Mayor?
Yes, ma'am.
Is it possible to see if there are anybody in the audience that would like to say a few things for Bert to maybe hear from concerned citizens that sometimes you get the calls? I know they're very frustrated that we're putting this responsibility on them
perhaps
to make the call.
We could do that during oral communications and Bert can
Yes, we could do that. We could do that. If you don't mind waiting a few minutes so to hear some of the concerned comments from citizens. Sure. Okay, that would be great. Thank you so much. Okay, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you, everybody,
okay,
for being here.
Okay, next is oral communications. There's a chance of people to address the council matters not on the agenda. Do we have any takers? Question.
Michelle Salmon, Brisbane resident. Bert, I have a question. When you talked about the operational counts not increasing that much in San Francisco, but I'm curious, I'd love to see those same charts for what's going on in Oakland, because I was very surprised when I took a departure out of Oakland and we like zoomed right over Brisbane. I'm like, woo, I can see my car. I can see my house. I can see people. We were that low. And it made me realize that all of the problem isn't just with SFO. And I'm wondering if you can address, maybe not tonight, but maybe next time, of what you're doing also in Oakland, and maybe bring your colleagues from the Oakland noise abatement with you so that we can work in concert to control all of it. Because some of the flights that we might be thinking are making that turn are actually originating out of Oakland or going to land in Oakland. And if we're only looking at one piece of the puzzle, we really need to address it all, because one of the charts you had also where it showed that 2 Solano Street dropped down, but the community noise dropped up, went up at that point. It's because 2 Solano is exactly just right past the bowl shape of Brisbane and gets the noise from the industrial park, but doesn't get the amplification that King's Road and the central part of Brisbane gets because of the bowl shape of the town. It's one of the reasons why the sound vibrates so much and is so intense. We've noticed this effect with, you know, concerts at Candlestick, you know, pile driving on the Baylands, etc. So if you could bring information about Oakland's flight patterns and their increase in operational counts, etc. as well, that'd be very appreciated. Okay.
Please.
Actually, Oakland's traffic is down considerably. The Oakland traffic...
I'm sorry, Bert. I interrupt you. The reason is because it's being televised.
Yes.
And people can see you when you look this way. It's okay. People
All right.
can hear.
The Oakland traffic is down. One of the last counts I heard, and this is a while ago, so it's not correct anymore, I'm sure. But they were definitely in the double digits. I believe they were close to 30% down. American used to be there since 1947. They pulled out altogether. JetBlue had everything over there. They moved bulk of the operations over to SFO, and they pulled a lot out of San Jose to compete. So, yes, both airports are down. Also, too, when things are down like this, that's kind of the way it works. Instead of being spread out all over the place, airlines will tend to consolidate at one airport. Easier for them to compete, and also easier for them to pool resources and keep a smaller staff. As they realize that, gosh, it's getting a problematic at SFO, too much traffic, too much whatever, they'll start to spread back out. It's just really the natural progression of things, and that's the way it's worked for years, and I'm sure it'll work the way again.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jenna Corlett. I'm a Brisbane resident, and I go to Lippman Middle School. So if all, like you said on your charts, if the airplanes are, you know, not having that much noise, then what are the airplanes that I hear all day long, all morning, all night, that are incredibly low that I can actually see at night because of the lights and see in the daytime? That are so low I can read the numbers on the bottom of the plane.
Good eyesight. I won't deny that one. Yes, definitely good eyesight. As far as the aircraft overflying the city, I don't know if you remember the graph we had up earlier. The altitudes of our lower-end flights were in the 3,000-foot range. And that's a relatively low aircraft. If you think of approaching aircraft over Foster City, they're about 2,000 feet, so about 1,000 feet higher as they come over the city here. So definitely good eyesight. Being able to identify the airplanes here and everything else, I totally understand that. I'm also not saying that there is an aircraft noise here. There is. Brisbane is within... 4 linear miles of San Francisco Airport. There is going to be some aircraft noise with the city this close. What we are trying to do is manage it and bring it down to a reasonable level that is something that everybody can deal with.
Thank you.
Thank you, Bert.
Thank you.
Anybody else?
I have a few questions for you, Bert, if I may.
How about phone from us? Your name and your city.
Barry Collette, Brisbane resident.
Brisbane resident. Thank you.
First, to go back to one of your slides, you had some numbers up there that had statistics for air taxi and air carrier. Mm-hmm. It's not clear to me what those are.
Air carriers are airlines.
Air carriers are airlines.
Air taxis, what they call a Part 135 operators, so some of the fractional jet operators, like a business.
Okay, business jets. Mm-hmm. Okay. So air carriers are really what we're talking about here today for the most part, Virgin, United, Southwest, etc. Okay. Okay. Good. Second question is really about trying to understand the relationship you have with the airlines. There's several different parties at play here. We have the airlines, we have the FAA, we have the air traffic controllers. I think, you know, it would be really good to understand who's in charge, right? And who do we need to speak to solve our problem here? And, you know, how does this work? You've talked about working with folks on your slide, meeting. That's great, and we appreciate the support that you put in for Brisbane. But we're really trying to understand, you know, who makes the rules, and who enforces them.
Yeah. Do you have any other questions?
I do. Shall I finish with the questions first?
And well, why don't you? And then we can get.
Yeah. Okay. I'd like to, agree wholeheartedly with Seppi's point that the CNAL is just a useless statistic, as far as we're concerned. It's the peaks, and I think when we're talking about peaks, it's not single events. We need to look at the top 5% or the top 3% of noise makers. Right, and look at those. Okay, CNAL, great.
That's what we did with our study. We grabbed the three.
No, not in terms of airlines, but in aircraft, okay?
We grabbed the bulk. More than 3%, well more.
Well, I don't know what the right number is, but, we should be looking at peak data rather than average data. And then finally, my question is, you mentioned stakeholders in the process of trying to redefine the air routes in and out of San Francisco, and how is the city of Brisbane a stakeholder in that process? Because certainly it is. We have to live with the consequences of the noise that's generated by those choices. Okay.
Thank you, Bert.
Okay, I think I got them all written down right. We got the clarification of air taxi and air carrier satisfied, I believe. Who to meet with? Well, I'd like to believe that we're the one-stop shop. The reason being is we know most of all the players out there, and we're willing to meet for you. We believe we're a middle person, truthfully. Yes, I do get paid by the airport, but my tasking is to make sure that the airlines, the FAA, and anybody else I need to comes to the table so we can make things work. And so I believe I'm your person for that. Who makes the rules? Well, that's easy. The FAA makes the rules, Federal Aviation Administration. Although Congress has helped tie our hands on certain things with like the Airport Noise and Capacity Act in 1990, there's certain things that I cannot make an airline do, like tell them when to operate, how to operate, or what to operate. That's spelled out by Congress back in 1990. I believe it was November 5th, actually. So we made a compromise with the airlines a long time ago where they would not have us breathing down their necks on very specific things. We would try to help them out with certain things, and they would get rid of older, noisier airplanes in 2000. Well, they did that. Well, there have been very few airports that have actually been able to change this and either get a curfew or something like that, modify certain things. One that comes to mind is Naples. There's three other airports doing it. It's very expensive, very protracted, and very long process. That's about all I can say about as far as making that big rule change. In the interim, as far as working with people, we're free to do that and can do it all until the sun comes down every night, and I am doing that to the best of our ability. CNEL is useless. Okay, we've already had that discussion. I'm not going to argue it. I'm just going to tell you that that's what I have to use as far as the state and the federal government works. As far as peak data, well, what we did is we used the analysis information that we came up with, and we were looking for the airlines that had the most complaints, the most noise, and the three that we grabbed were Southwest, Virgin America, and United Airlines, who had the bulk of it all. So we're not even talking 3%. We're talking more. So that's why we grabbed those. As far as stakeholders go, the initial on the Bay Area airspace redesign is going to be done with the governmental agencies, CCAG, the FAA, and various city planners that are in the area. So as far as the specifics on that, I'll have to get the information and give it over to you as who all the meeting parties are. I just saw a recent meeting announcement on that, and I know the laundry list was absolutely huge for names on that one. So if you aren't already on it, I'll see about what we can do for you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Anyone else?
Hi.
Hi.
Hi. My name is Peter Grace. I live in Brisbane. And I do want to say to Bert, you know, I value what you do. I sort of feel you've got a really lousy job. You know, I'm saying that up front. Let me say I wrote to Bert today. I got an email answer from him at 6:04 this evening. So, you know, you're working both ends. And I feel, to be honest, you've got a position where you've been sent out to get shot. And that's your job. And I, you know, my concern, following up on what Cliff was saying, is that it's not the flights that are coming off runways 10L and 10R. It's the ones that go over the bay and then off runways R19R and turn left. And those are the ones that are turning left over Brisbane. They're going over the bay and then turning left. And those are the ones that are causing the peak events that are really upsetting people, me included. And the question is for me, is why are they turning and who's controlling the aircraft at that point? What I'm hearing is, and I don't understand really what's going on, I hear that there's this 4 mile distance. Here at City Hall, I measured today from the center of the runways on a GPS, I measured today from the center of the runways at SFO to here, it's 4.65 miles. So someone is allowing these planes to turn left earlier. And so when you said that, you know, what I think what we're seeing is we're seeing planes turning left earlier. And so this is what this diagram here demonstrates, that this comes from the noise website, and it shows the tracks that, you know, what I'm seeing is a lot over central Brisbane, and it's that peak noise that's really upsetting people, amongst others. I'd also like to know what is the cost savings to the aircraft from turning left earlier? What is it, $20, $30? How much is the ill will created because of that? You know, I'd like to know, you know, is it $60? What is it?
This is not a question.
Are you through with your question?
And the other questions I've got is, I looked at the San Jose Mineta Airport, and one of the things they talked about was saying staff does not investigate every complaint made by frequent callers because they are often repetitive in nature, and the staff may have previously spoken to the caller about their concerns. Does that happen here at SFO as well? And what is the number?
Yes, we're responsible.
Okay. And the final thing is, I'd really be interested in the data from the single events from the Margaret Street noise counter, because it's the peak events that are causing the concern. I'm not interested, to be honest, in the average events. You know, it's the peak noise which is really hurting us all and is leading to these complaints. As I said at the beginning, I think you've got a hard job, so thanks a lot.
Well, truthfully, it's working with good people that actually makes it a decent job. I mean, we've worked together for how long now?
Since 95.
You've been able to take a bite out of my hind end every now and then, and
yeah,
we're still friends. I do have a fairly thick hide, but some of this I do take personally. I'm not going to lie to you. I don't think I'd do my job as well if I didn't. So I hope you accept that and accept that we're going forward with it for you. You mentioned the runway. You said runway 19. It's actually runway 1, which is the opposite end of that runway. Runways are numbered based on a compass heading. So if you consider 19, it's actually 190, so it's 010. And so it's runway 01 to the north, which turns left on a port departure. I have some charts with me. I'd be happy to show you exactly what's going on out in the lobby afterwards. And yes, that's what's from the complaints that we have looked at, from the information we had in December, January, and prior to that, I believe the port departures are the biggest of the noise influence issues here. Although the rudest are the shorelines and the quiets that jump over the back of the mountain and wake you up in the middle of the night when you don't expect an airplane coming through. What is the cost of the ill will with an airplane turning early? Well, if a as a pilot, I can tell you that an air traffic controller tells you turn left, you're going to turn left. Typically because you believe that the person in charge has told you to do that. You're not thinking about the cost of it. You may, as you do it, say, oh goodness, we're getting going early and we can shave a few minutes off the flight. That's great. But as far as wanting to do that, you may want to do it, but you're going to fly the departure procedures charted, and which is departing out to 4 miles, making sure you have 1,600 feet, and then executing the left turn as indicated on the chart. Single event data, I'd be more than happy, Mr. Graves, to give you that. If you'd like to come by the office or if we mail you a disk, let's just sit down and talk about it. We have the raw data ready to go for you.
Thank you. I think we're going to close this communication for now. You have enough information to provide for us to get us the report at your convenience. And I think the people have brought some very interesting questions. At least that's, you've heard them personally rather than a telephone call, you know. So I appreciate your help and I thank you very much for coming. If we've offended you, I am terribly sorry, but thank you very much. Okay, next item, we got to stop this. We'll be here all night. Of course it's important. It's important to all of us who live in Brisbane.
Mr. Mayor, there were two people that raised their hands. If you don't mind, if you allow those two to finish, then we won't add anyone, because I've seen their hands have been up all this time. Maybe I'd like to suggest if you can take those two.
Go ahead, then.
Mine isn't airport related, so.
Oh, okay. Just, okay.
Mine is airport related.
Okay. I took notes in my phone, so I just want to.
Okay,
good. Good memory. I'm Anna Maria Hernandez-Berry, Brisbane resident of 8 or 9 years, and mother of 4 little ones, and I can't wear earplugs. So what bothers me particularly is the 6 to 7 a.m. window. And basically, the reduced power takeoffs because it reduces fuel. Just wondering, could we at least request that between 6 and 7, you not do the reduced power? I mean, just for now, can we make small changes that would make us all so much happier? Like, I understand you can't make an airline do anything, but if we can at least request. I understand that years ago, San Bruno, the city of San Bruno had double pane windows or soundproof windows, and they were subsidized by someone. I don't know exactly what the entity was that was doing it, but I feel like if they can get that, why can't we at least get a noise curfew with the airline that between 6 and 7 we aren't going to have these, you know, sometimes it's 30 flights. And it's, I mean, I've sat out and watched them because they wake me up and then I'm irritated by it. And it's the, you know, it's the takeoff from SFO and the big fat U-turn over Brisbane. And it's so annoying because it's, I mean, they might as well be dragging a banner behind them because it looks like they're taking the scenic route over and around Brisbane. And the really loud one on January 4th, Cathay Pacific, when I called and complained and I received a response, I was shocked to hear that it was going to China because it looked like it was going to Reading. It was like dead north, and I could count the red lights on the wings. It was that close to us. So, and that's a really sort of a frightening thing, living in the era that we live in, to hear this loud noise. You know, you look out the window and you have no idea what to expect. So I also want, let's see. So when they do something that's so blatantly, you know, rude, as we call that, rude departure, are they penalized in any way? Can we do anything like that? And that's it. That's all I have. Sorry.
Thank you very much.
Thanks.
You have those down. That's okay. You have those down. You can include them in your comments. I'd appreciate that. Who else had a hand up? I didn't see you. Thank you, Doctor. Dana.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. Dana Dilworth, Brisbane resident. I wanted to talk about the city's website. I'm finding it difficult to find information that on, if you Google something, it'll indicate that there's a document that the Google is attaching itself to, but then it opens up on the original page, and there's no way to figure out how to get to that document. The second issue was, I believe John Sawicki had told us that the notice of preparation was going to stay on that first page for the Baylands, and somehow it's disappeared into the realm. And I would appreciate if you would consider having a section that says public notice, because the public notices get lost. And it's really unfair for people to have to look through the blog, look through minutes, look through 10 or 15 different documents to find the statutorily required documents. So I'd appreciate if you could give some consideration to the Brisbane City website, and not use the blog as instead of public notice. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan. Clay, could you talk to DIT and see if we can come up with that?
Yeah, I did, but I do want to just, we don't.
Please do. Go ahead.
The blog is not used in lieu of public notice, just so we get that on the record. But yeah, we'll take a look at the concerns and make adjustments as necessary.
Thank you. Okay. Any other oral communications? No. All right. Adoption of the consent calendar. We've completed item M, as in Mary. How about items A through L?
Give you a motion to approve A through L.
I would like for us to, I had a question for item J, but everything else is fine.
Item J, okay. And everything else is fine?
My motion amended to exclude
item J. Thank you.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Thank you. Item J.
Let me pull that thing out. Okay. In regards to item J, we're asking the council to approve that McGrath Yachts, who's a broker, have some of the boats that he is trying to sell in the marina. That's correct.
Through the mayor, yes. Thank you, council member. We're actually using an incentive to get him to bring boats from outside the area into the marina, and thereby the 50%, hopefully, if I understand boater behavior correctly, a lot of boaters, once they get into a marina and they're comfortable there, they tend to stay there. And so what we're hoping is that with a broker bringing the boat into the marina and showing the boat there, that the new buyer will hopefully keep the boat in the marina.
Keep it in the marina. Okay.
So there's a financial incentive for them to bring the boat into the marina. Currently, we're at 90% occupancy. We've been maintaining that for the last year. I think we could probably kick it up a few more percent.
So how many boats would you need to have full occupancy?
About 60 boats right now.
So you have 60 berths that are vacant?
Yes.
Okay. And so the broker probably would not have 60 boats to offer.
No.
Okay. And that was my concern that, when I see this number of 88%, there might only be just a few berths left. And then if they're filled with these boats that we're trying to sell and we have a whole year to allow them to say they're at half the price?
Yeah, the discounted vessels would not be displacing other vessels that normally would come in on an ordinary basis. For instance, about on average, we turn over about 11 slips per month. That's 11 people leaving and 11 new people coming in. Okay. And I don't see those discounted vessels at all displacing that turnover.
Okay.
If that answers your question.
That is. That okay, is. Thank you for that. Yeah, no, I think, I think it's a great move to get more folks in the marina. So thanks. That was it, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. I too have a concern about this. I don't have a concern about improving business, of course. But using a public building for a private enterprise somehow bothers me. I'm not comfortable with that at all. And I'm just wondering if we're setting some kind of an example.
Mr. Mayor,
if you want to continue.
Yeah, if I could address that.
Sure.
The building's only going to be accessible to the op broker during our normal business hours. So he won't be coming or going while there's no city staff there, if that makes sense to you. In other words, city staff will always be there at the time he's there. When we're closed, he won't have access to the building.
What about storage of your equipment, files, and all that?
He's only taken about 182 square feet on the second floor, so we've got plenty of room for additional storage and stuff. It's a very underutilized area.
And he's paying rent, though.
He's paying rent. There's no downside to the city here.
No, so there's no free lunch for the
right.
The space. All right.
Does the city attorney have any concerns about...
No, I don't. Number one, he's paying rent. And number two, it's a use directly related to the marina, and to some extent it will promote the marina as boats are sold there and stay there as occupants. So I think it certainly is a compatible use, and it's a use that's routinely conducted by other marinas as well.
Thank you. Was that a motion, Mr. Councilmember?
Oh, sure, yes. A motion to approve consent calendar item J.
Motion and second by Councilmember. The Mayor Pro Tem. All those in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you. Okay, now we come to the interesting part of the agenda. Not that the prior wasn't interesting and informative. Item 7, public hearing. A, consider adoption of Resolution 2011-01, adopting the 2007-2014 housing element. This is visit number 5 to this document. Is that what I hear? Or is there more?
To the council, yes. There were some other sessions before the Planning Commission as well, yes.
Oh, I see. Okay.
Thank you.
Can you give us a brief?
Sure. Thank you, Honorable Mayor, member of the councils. As you indicated, this housing element, which is a mandatory requirement of state law for the city to periodically update the housing element. The period in question is 2007 to 2014. As you can see, we're in the tipping point of more than halfway through that element, which should have been adopted some time ago. There have been a number of, there's been an extensive public review process, both in front of the Planning Commission, several hearings and workshops. As you mentioned, about 5 workshops in front of the City Council or meetings, hearings on this particular item. And then the last action was last June of 2010. The Council reviewed the document and authorized staff to submit it to HCD, which is the state reviewing body. We did review it, and we've received several rounds of comments and discussion with HCD. And the final action from HCD was a letter we received in December, which was basically to find the element that's in front of you tonight as being in compliance with state law. So that is a certifiable housing element at this point in time. The changes that were made through the process between the review of HCD and the draft you saw in June are primarily what I characterize as editorial in nature. They had certain language they wanted worked in a number of topics and areas. There was really only one we would consider substantive comment. As you're aware, there are certain limitations on, for projects to qualify as being eligible to for low or moderate income, that there's certain density, 20 unit per acre density that's required, as well as a minimum project size. We weren't aware of the project size limitation. It says you have to have a project of 16 units to qualify, again, a presumption of being affordable. So the modification that took, which is reflected in the draft element you have before you tonight, is to increase the minimum parcel size in the new Southwest Bayshore Residential District that was proposed. Again, that was a proposal you saw before. The only change was to increase the minimum lot size, thereby allowing for the project minimum to comply with the state requirement of 16. So you have an overlay of 20 units to the acre, but you also have a project of 16 units. So those are the two kind of factors, and the development standards reflect that now. Again, per state law, the city has until October 1st, 2012 to adopt the necessary rezonings to provide the sites required as specified in the housing element. There was some discussion with the Planning Commission recently about the need for a form-based code or zoning to implement the two new districts, the Crocker Park mixed use and the Southwest Bayshore Residential. And we did commit to work with them on an educational process. Form-based zoning is a tool that, although it's used in California with some regularity, has not been used here in Brisbane, and that basically requires a little more upfront education and work, because what you do, instead of creating a series of development standards and then a project basically being able to interpret those standards as they see fit, and then the city sort of reviewing the project, the development standards are rather front-loaded. Yeah, and so basically the city, through the zoning, establishes a vision and the standards to achieve that vision. And so that is the tool that that we recommend be used to implement the two new districts, primarily because the state requirements are that you can't apply discretionary review to these kind of projects. You have to approve them at a fixed density. You can't reduce their density and still get credit through the state requirements. So that is a sort of a key implementation step I did want to highlight, and the Planning Commission did have some concerns, and we did commit to work with them to make sure they're very comfortable with the process. And again, that will be a separate notification process and a separate rezoning procedure we'll go through independently of the adoption of this element. So that staff is recommending adoption of the 2007 to 2014 housing element, and that would conclude my comments.
Thank you. Council questions?
I do. I have quite a few. So if
go ahead.
The council members want to go first.
Go ahead. Go ahead.
Okay. First of all, commend the staff for putting together this report. This draft is, I think an excellent housing element document because it not only addresses the needs of housing, but it takes a more holistic approach in that housing also affects all the other parts of our lives. And addresses things like climate change and accessibility to public transportation, our relationship with where we work, and just having a more cohesive neighborhood, and really looking at where Brisbane is today, and ensuring that our values are in place moving forward for future housing development. So it was an excellent document. And even though my wife would say it's pretty dry reading, I really enjoyed going through it. So I do have some questions. I'll start with the staff report first. That issue about the the size of the lots and having to have being able to require at least 16 units. So, you know, some of those properties could not accommodate the amount of units that are required to achieve the affordable housing. So, how do you recommend that those property owners set up their properties to be able to accomplish that?
Well, certainly we'll be, and there's some new policy language that was added to promote property and lot consolidation to achieve that. And actually, a number of the parcels, when we started doing the site-by-site review, a number of the parcels are in common ownership already, so it'll be fairly readily consolidated to be able to achieve that requirement. So I'd say it's probably about half and half, or half will readily could achieve that, and the rest will, you know, will certainly promote the consolidation, and there's some policies we'll try to apply to. But that'll really be the tool, is to consolidate those parcels to achieve the minimum project size.
Okay. All right. Now, for the document. It was interesting to see that Brisbane's population has increased. Now we're just shy of 4,000 people. So 3,938 is the new census numbers. Group quarters. We have some group quarters in central Brisbane. Could you just briefly talk about that and the importance of that?
Well, again, group quarters are a special need group identified through the housing element and housing element law that you have to accommodate, provide reasonable accommodation for. And with that segue, I'll turn it over to Tim Toon, the senior planner, who might be able to get into more detail about the specific requirements or the zoning for those.
We actually have two different types of group quarters in Brisbane. One would be more...
Tim, would you please?
Let's see. We have two types of group quarters in Brisbane. One would be more the kind of social service facility where you'll have a number of people who live together and are going through some type of treatment for addictions, typically. The other that actually has a probably longer history in Brisbane are the communal living arrangements, that we still have a few of these in Brisbane, where a number of people who are not necessarily related live together in a common household. So those are the two types of group quarters we have.
All right. And then there's talk in this document about having an emergency shelter. So currently we do not have an emergency shelter for, battered women or things like that.
That's correct. And I think, the state requirement is you have to provide the zoning, the infrastructure, the regulatory infrastructure to permit it, not necessarily that one has to be constructed as a condition of this housing element, but that there are no regulatory obstacles to being able to construct one.
Okay, and it's recommended that the Southwest Bayshore sub-area would be a good location for that.
And if I could clarify on that, emergency shelter is intended for homeless persons.
For homeless.
Specifically.
Okay. The height limits for the rezoning of the warehouse properties to mixed use. So there's a three-story height limit, 35 feet. There's a 35-foot cap right? So that there wouldn't be three stories plus a garage.
That's correct. And again, those standards will be fully codified when we actually rezone those sites. So, you know, the commission and the council will have an opportunity to review them in sort of a final form. So all those kind of details in very specific form.
Okay, that's good. There's some talk about form-based codes. I'll save that for the end. In the report, in regards to the Southwest Bayshore District, with the potential build-out, there would be a need for a traffic signal at that intersection of San Bruno and Bayshore.
Is that right? That's correct.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. And then the density bonus. So if the maximum amount of units that could be put into the new district that would have the mixed use, if you did a density bonus, you could have more units than 24 for the warehouse conversion, and then also the Southwest Bayshore, which would be 20. So if you did a density bonus, you could have more units. And how would the property owner go about doing that? What's that procedure like?
It would be subject to the standards that already exist in the zoning ordinance, which again is based on the requirements of state law. So we're not proposing new language necessarily related to those standards. It's carrying forward what the city zoning already stands for or calls for.
Okay, so so the NCRO 3 district, it's got a minimum density of 24, but a maximum of 29. So you could only through density transfer add five more units. Tim, you're shaking your head.
The density bonus provisions come from state law, and so there are complicated formulas involved with how many additional affordable units you include in your project as to what kind of a density bonus you could get. The whole point of a density bonus is that you get a bonus over the standard density that the city sets for that particular zoning district.
Okay. So how does that work out? Per how many units per acre you could potentially have?
It depends on the particulars of what's being proposed to qualify for the density bonus that state law allows. So
it is case by case.
It's a case by case, and it goes through the Planning Commission, and I believe some of these density bonuses actually require council approval.
Okay, all right. So the council has an opportunity to review those density transfers.
Bonuses. That's my recollection. Of course, we haven't had any proposals, so I don't have any direct experience.
All right. Density transfers is Brisbane Acres.
Yes.
Okay. Okay. Of course, there's talk about redevelopment agency involvement, but there's a possibility that there might not be redevelopment agency in a few months, and those things might not even apply. So we don't need to talk about those. You talked about condominium conversion controls. Could you briefly talk about some of the concerns of why that might not be a good thing for the city?
The city's municipal code already sets up a process for approval of condominium conversions with the intent that we want to make sure that there is a sufficient number of vacant rental units in the city to keep rentals rates low and affordable. So what the policy would do would be to basically take a look at updating the condominium conversion ordinance, because I think it dates back before my time here. So it's been on the books for a while.
Okay.
No significant changes, though, are proposed.
Okay. All right. The cooperative housing, I thought was interesting. I don't know if I see that anywhere in central Brisbane. It might have implications in other areas, perhaps. I'll pass on that one. Let's see, surplus of land and land banking. Where are there possibilities for that?
Actually, that would be one place where the city could get involved with the consolidation of the smaller parcels in the Southwest Bayshore area. Mm-hmm. Where the city could purchase properties as they become available on the market with the intent of eventually accumulating sufficient to be large enough to qualify for one of these theoretically affordable housing projects.
All right. And is there any federal land or state land that the city could buy that's in Brisbane that we know of?
No, not that.
No, there isn't. Okay. The Community Development Block Grant Program, can that be applied to mixed-use development, or is it just housing development only?
I'm going to have to, I'm not sure. We'd have to research that.
Okay. Okay. Let's see. And then, as part of the general plan in regards to encouraging the retention of affordable units by amending the zoning ordinance to designate the mobile home park in the Southwest Bayshore sub-area for mobile home uses only, I really support that. I think that's great that's in there. And the form-based codes, I took a look at the Planning Commission agenda, and just looking at the minutes and looking at the exchange that occurred, and I'm glad that Terry had spoken up to the commission, she said that. That zoning for increased density to get credit for potential lower income housing without form-based codes would allow cell blocks to be built without discretion. Ms. O'Connell did not want to limit innovation and suggested having a community architect brought in to advise the city on developing the form-based codes. Then the commission got together and collaborated, and I thought the Planning Commission came up with some really good recommendations to the council that adequate resources, expertise, and public participation would be required to implement the housing elements programs regarding form-based codes for the new zoning districts to ensure they reflect the expectations and needs of the community, and thus the request that the city council provide adequate resources as needed to facilitate successful implementation of the form-based codes. So, I mean, I think that was excellent recommendations from the commission. So then, where do we go from there?
Well, again, once the adoption occurs, there'll be a number of sort of implementation steps that would have to occur, the number of measures that we'll work on. But certainly the whole program for form-based coding, we'd have to basically come back to the commission and council with a sort of a suggested program. If there are resources needed, you know, obviously have that discussion and see what we can do to achieve the commission's expectations and the community's wishes in this matter.
Sure. I mean, of course, it's, you know, it'll be up to the council to decide, you know, if that's the direction that we want to go. But if that was the direction, you know, clearly having the community input is essential because, you know, we're not only looking at these buildings, but the potential of this public space and what do you do with it and how does it fit in with the existing park and other buildings that are along visitation and Old County. So, yeah, great job, and thank you very much. That's it, Mr. Mayor.
Thank you. Sebi?
No, I'm ready to hear from people.
Okay, this is a public hearing, and the council is satisfied with the questions. I have a slip from Terry O'Connell, who wishes to speak on the housing element. Terry?
Thank you. Terry O'Connell, Brisbane resident. And thank you, Cliff, for bringing up, because I still have concerns on the form-based code. It's hard to envision it working properly if we don't have an implementation plan prior to writing it into the housing element. So that worries me, and I'd like to make sure that the council addresses that and has a way of working that into the program before we get stuck with something we don't want. Because I don't know if it works this way, that as soon as we pass this housing element, someone could walk in and say, okay, I want to build. And if we don't have something specific and we can't restrict what we ask for, because it's part of the way we get credit for the low-income housing, it seems like right at this point, almost anyone could walk in and throw out a project, and we couldn't really say no. So I think it's very important that we get this implementation on the books. And I don't know how you manage that. It's the chicken before the egg kind of thing. So I'd just like to make sure that the council sees that as a potential problem. And that's about it for me. So thank you.
Thank you very much. The other slip I have is from Dana Dilworth. Dana, are you ready?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I had a difficulty understanding just exactly what these changes are, because there was just a little reference to a planning commission meeting that said to look at a couple of pages. And out of that, I printed out about 14 pages on insert number one, and about 6 pages on insert number 2. And so it's not the continuous housing element. And because of that, I want to know if 99 North Hill Drive, 91 Park Lane, 105 Park Lane, and 280 Old County Road are still destined to be changed. Because that's on your table 3411-III. There were other because this started out with a initial study in 2007, one of the things that it says is that it will allow for a modification for some properties at 253 Humboldt, 1145 Humboldt, 10 Kings, 315 Kings, 119 Tulare. Have these landowners been informed of this meeting, that their land is being proposed to be rezoned? Did they get proper notification? Are these still parts of this housing element? It's really hard to tell when all we get are the cliff notes from the planning director. Just in general, just because of the new regulations that went into effect on January 1st that require municipalities to consider and remedy, not just consider, greenhouse gas emissions, this initial study and document are totally inadequate. I'm going to submit the USGS maps for this area, which show that the area that you have now designated for some of the most dense housing is subject to liquefaction. And also, I'm going to submit the documents from GeoTracker that indicate about all the leaking underground storage tanks. These tell us the known ones. We don't know the unknown ones that might have occurred in the Crocker Industrial Park. And the reason I say this now is because too many times we have plans that come before us and we're told, no impact, no impact. And yet these very clearly are going to have impacts. I also find that the rezoning of the Brisbane Acres to allow this dense housing actually ends up being the antithesis of, or just that there's no guarantee that there will be any part of that area that will be protected and saved according to the HCP. And somehow that should be written into the housing element, that the dangers of these should be written into the general plan, that the site description, the problems that we had on the Ng property were the hillside being subject to movement. And so we've got liquefaction, we've got hazardous waste, and we've got other dangers that are totally being ignored by this technique, by trying to fulfill a state mandate. And I wish you would, first of all, properly notice this document in its entirety so that people can read from beginning to end instead of have to figure it out through the cliff notes, through the city agenda notes. Thank you.
Thank you, Dana. Next, I have Michelle Salmon. Michelle?
I shouldn't touch this. That guy was sick. Michelle Salmon, Brisbane resident. First of all, I'd just like to say that this has been a really tedious process for all of us, and I still want it on the record that I object to having the state cram this down our throats, and I hope we do better in the next round and really fight back and not accept this kind of thing. In that, I am very concerned about Southwest Bayshore and that level of density in particular. I keep imagining a whole row of concrete blocks stuck against the hillside and then gunited concrete in between to keep the hillside from sliding down, similar to what they did up by on Geneva where the bowling alley used to be. And That really concerns me a lot, and it is part of the habitat, and it is a sensitive area, and I question that, and I am also very concerned about what Terry brought up about the form-based code, the design review issues. To quote what, sort of semi-quote what John said earlier, common ownership already, so half could act readily in that area to force through a development as soon as this is passed, when we don't have the proper form-based codes and everything in laid out for how we're going to manage that, if indeed we do allow that level of density of housing along Southwest Bay Shore. So that's a big concern for me. And then also I feel like maybe people aren't as quite aware as they should be about this housing element. I know they should be aware because we've certainly had a lot of meetings and a lot of notices. But if you remember a year ago, we sat through meeting after meeting on the housing element. And at one point, Terry and I were the only people in the audience, and you guys sort of approved a plan. And then people around town got word of the plan that you wanted a density of 20 units per acre in certain parts of Brisbane. And that plan had to be thrown out and start over again, or not start over again, but you know, reevaluate because people all of a sudden realize that, wow, that's my property. So I think Dana raises an interesting point about notification of property owners. Do they really understand what you're noticing? I read a notice that was sent to another property owner. It was pretty vague. They have property on Tulare Street. And they had no clue what they were here for tonight. And so I think that really, I wouldn't be hasty. I know this has been a long process, but I wouldn't be hasty about approving this without really making sure everyone understands the changes that have happened since what you suggested in June and what it looks like now. And also that we really have a firm handle on what we're opening the door for now in terms of dense development along Bay Shore. Thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else?
You have a motion to close the public hearing.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? The ayes have it. What's the council's pleasure?
If it's okay, Mr. Mayor, again, there were some questions that were raised by the public. If be okay if John Sawicki can answer those, especially there was, you know, the question that came up twice regarding do we have a time frame of where we can implement the form-based codes if that's where we want to go prior to a project being brought forth to the planning department.
But if I may, through the chair, I think there is a very good point that's raised in terms of sort of the exposure to the city of not having our sites fully rezoned. And I'll defer to the city attorney, I'd make the argument that the city's exposure is probably greater by not having an adopted housing element, because arguably someone could come in for an affordable project in a lot of places in town, and that the city doesn't have regulations in place, you really have very little control or no control over that sort of project, and it wouldn't be limited to the Southwest Bay Shore or, you know, the Crocker Park site. But
let me just amplify. When we say form-based code, the word that seems to be getting ignored is the word code. Nobody's going to show up at the counter tomorrow and ask for a building permit. What we're talking about is a form of zoning regulation that goes the next step beyond simply saying you have X number of feet as a setback, X number of feet as height, and X number of square footage that's allowed. It's really dealing in more detail with the form of the structures that's going to go on the site, and John can, you know, correct me on any of this, but what we're talking about is the consideration and adoption of a zoning ordinance that would change the way we evaluate applications or the way applications are prepared. Until that ordinance is adopted, we don't have form-based codes. There is no code. So the first step would be to go back to the Planning Commission and talk about what the content of this ordinance is going to be, The Planning Commission can then put together an ordinance through the public hearing process and then come to the council, just like any other zoning ordinance, which again would go through public hearings and would be adopted by the council. So we are a long, long way from a building permit based upon a form-based code, because at this point we don't have a form-based code. So that whole concern that someone's going to show up with something is just not really a concern. The concern should be what is the content of this ordinance, and there'll be plenty of opportunity for the public to look at it, to make comments on it, and to participate in the process of developing these regulations, and that's really all we're talking about.
Mm. Okay. But were there any other questions that you just wanted to comment on, John?
Well, certainly, again, the availability of the housing element has been in form, various forms, draft since the summer. The final draft since December has been available at the City Hall, through the website, and at the library as well. So again, there has been access to that.
Excuse me, where on the website? Because I've been looking.
That's through that.
Should not do this.
It's up to the chair. Through the chair, do you care for us to respond, or?
No, that's all right. I think we left instructions for the city manager to correct that particular problem that people are having with getting to the websites. That shouldn't happen, but it does. Just let me at a computer and watch the problems.
The other comment I would offer is that I don't think there's anything in here that would in any manner nullify the HCP. The HCP is in place. The land that's subject to the HCP would have to go through the whole HCP process. And I don't think we're talking about blanketing the Brisbane acres with high-density housing. There are some areas in the lower end of it that we've always looked at as, you know, potential sites, but, you know, it's certainly nothing here that's intended to negate the protection of the hillside that's now provided by the HCP.
Mm-hmm. And there is no rezoning proposed in Brisbane Acres. That was another concern raised. That's not part of the proposal.
So, you know, Clark's not here, and I know that he probably would want to have some input on this. How does the council feel?
Well, if he'd wanted to have input, he could have asked us to continue it.
Okay.
Yes, he would have. But we have a majority of the council, and I don't. So we can make a decision here tonight if we want to.
It's a requirement. Hmm? We need to do this. Yeah. This is not something that it's up to us. It's one of those things that there are concerns. We know that. At the same time, it's a requirement. So I'd like to make a motion to approve it.
You mean to adopt resolution?
To adopt the resolution, yes.
-01?
Yes, yes, yes.
I'll second the motion.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Let the record show it was unanimous. And then any further concerns that may be brought up in the future, we can certainly address those at the time. Thank you. Okay, we've closed the public hearing, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Under old business, we have considered the use of beautification funds for the calendar year 2011 to provide a partial offset of water billing for the Brisbane Nursery at San Bruno Mountain Watch. Council, I'll tell you what. I have a request from Terry O'Connell, but on the bottom it says, if staff has questions.
Or the council.
Or the council.
On behalf of San Bruno Mountain.
Thank you.
I just have a quick question. I don't remember last time when this item came about, they said, okay, we do it for 1 year. What are the plans after that? So I forgot what was, do you know what are the plans after that?
Well, I think in the staff report and in the material that's attached, they are looking at making some changes to their irrigation system. And okay. Perhaps Terry can speak to that. But
yeah,
the bottom line was that they were going to work on trying to have lower their demand of water. And then this year will give them an opportunity to do that and have some of the money that they'll save to be able to put towards the irrigation system.
Is this ever going to be, is this a covered facility or? Do you have a roof on it, Terry? Do you remember?
It's not a covered facility. It's got shade cloth, but it needs to mimic the environment that the plants are going to go back out into. So it can't be a completely enclosed structure.
Thank you.
So were you going to respond to that?
Do you have a question?
Yes, I did. And that's my question was, would you remind me? Last time when we talked about that, this is a one-time deal. So Mountain Watch is going to be planning for their future water use?
We are planning for the future water use. As the nursery gets underway, there's been a lot of construction costs and really no revenue. We've been using the plants that we've been growing for the Crocker Trail restoration up on Army Road, and so inputting them back into the community, but not selling them, so to speak. We want to grow the nursery and be able to put the resources back into building the facility out. And as the facility gets built out and we're able to distribute plants through other methods, our budget, we've sent a budget into with our request showing that our budget's changing and that our water needs are going to be going down.
Okay. Thank you very much. I think this is a wonderful thing, and I'd like to ask that we accommodate this request.
I think the recent project you had was on San Benito and Sierra Point, didn't you? You cleaned the bank, I think.
They
got some of your native plants up there?
I believe so. The most recent was last Saturday, planting up off Army Road also.
Okay. Was that a motion, Seppi?
I would yes, I would make that a motion that we grant this request.
I'll second the motion.
Okay. And I just had a question on this. This is a special circumstance, and I can see the benefit of native plants and so on. Now, if anyone else comes in and asks for the same reduction in water bills, can we stop them?
Well, yeah. This is a discretionary decision on the City Council's part.
Okay. And we're not using water funds.
Correct.
We're using beautification funds.
Correct.
Okay. Okay, we have a motion and a second. Motion, all in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed?
Thank you, Council.
Thank you. So you don't need to speak on this one.
Okay.
Okay. Staff reports.
The only item I had tonight, excuse Mr. Mayor, and a couple of the council members may want to speak to this, is there has been some requests that we consider, as you we all know, that there's been tremendous flooding in our sister city in Brisbane, Australia.
Yes.
And that there's been a request for us to consider doing something in that light. And it could be as simple as sending a letter of support. There's a website I know that's available that people can make donations on. So with that, I know at least Council Member Richardson, I think the mayor have also been thinking about this issue.
Yeah, we're still part of the Sister Cities program, aren't we?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, good. And I think we should at least, the mayor and the council, or just the mayor, sent a letter to them, expressing our concern, and then if there's a way we could provide some place that people could donate money to that could go to those to relief, I don't know if that's even possible?
Yeah, I think we could do something on our website that would direct people to the proper place to do that. And we'll, we can blog it, and we'll try to give some note or some publicity in the community with regards to the issue, and the if people want to help out, where they can go to.
And instead of, and actually we'll send a letter, that's important, but I think what you might want to do is, I don't know, contact them if at all possible and see how we could get, make sure that the money gets to them and doesn't get waylaid somewhere. Not by us, would, but you know.
Would you like some senior staff members to take a trip down there?
Would you mind?
No, we'll do that. That's a good idea.
Fair Political Practices Commission hasn't got much to do today.
Mr.
Thank
Mayor.
You very much. I appreciate that. That's great.
Mr. Mayor,
yes.
I've been working with staff to draft a letter for a couple of cities that we have association with from our city, Ipswich and Brisbane, from your signature and our community. We're concerned to what happened to the
Absolutely.
People.
Absolutely.
And also show our support and also commend the strength that those people have in going through what they have gone, and they've been helping one another to really survive and offer our assistance in any way we can. They're, after all, our sisters or brothers. So you would be getting a letter for your signature.
I appreciate that.
If I may, Mr.
Yes,
Mayor.
Sir.
So Clay, the city could collaborate with the Lions Club or the Boy Scouts to where they could rent out the Mission Blue Center or the community center at a discounted price for free, and to host some kind of fundraiser for the. Maybe an organization, maybe a school or something like that in the city of Brisbane, Australia. Is that something that...
Yeah, and I think we...
I think the Lions Club would be the best one because they are in contact with them.
You know, that would be great if a nonprofit from Brisbane could work with the staff to coordinate some kind of event where then the people of Brisbane could come and support... our sister city in Australia, and
Sounds
also
good.
Just have an opportunity for the community, right. our community, to get together to help those in need.
Sounds good.
We have established contacts with the new group in Brisbane, Australia. The contacts the Lions had with Lord Mayor.
Right.
It's he's dead and gone, and the new regime in Australia, it's kind of really hard to get to them, but we have created
not through the Lions Club.
Correct. No, that's given. So we do have opportunity to do something well.
Yeah, so, you know, if you could maybe kind of organize that, that'd be nice.
We'll do that.
Yeah.
I'll let the president know, and we'll go from there.
Okay, great.
Okay, that's all on city manager. Thank you. Mayor Council Matters, subcommittee reports.
I wanted to share, I was going to talk about this sister city letter and on flood in Australia that's handled. Second is the high-speed rail policy group have been canceling a lot of their meetings, so I think this month is also canceled. All kinds of stuff is happening. The head of the, between Caltrain and High Speed Rail, Bob Doty, that was really big honcho in making this happen, has resigned to go work for private industry, and is going to be recognized tomorrow night at Caltrain meeting that I have. So there are all kinds of changes happening. So for now, the High Speed Policy Group is not going to be meeting during this couple of months, or at least a month.
So you got
to see habits, to see what happens next. That's
okay.
It.
That's it.
Uh-huh.
Anybody else? Nobody else? Yes, sir.
Yeah, Clark and I have had a couple of meetings with the Economic Development Subcommittee, and we've met with Mitch Bull and Larry Purcell of the Chamber, and the meetings have been very energetic. And just getting their insight regarding the pulse of the business community has been very, very helpful. And, you know, just trying to come up with, you know, what are Brisbane's business values? You know, what are the types of businesses that would bring needed revenue to the city? You know, how do you outreach to these potential businesses? And so we've just started that, and it's going in a very good direction, and I look forward to sharing with you the next update that we have.
Sounds good. Thank you. Anybody else? No? Okay. Consider setting Monday, January 31st, 2011 at 7:30 p.m. as a city council workshop regarding citywide issues.
That's okay with me.
Everybody can say.
Yep.
Yeah, that's my birthday.
Happy birthday.
That's all right.
Working, earn your pay.
My wife knows. So we're good.
That's it.
So we'll do it then.
Yeah. We have a motion and a second? Okay. We will do that. Now, this is going to be, is this a closed session? This is going to be open to the public, isn't it?
This is the basically the annual goal-setting session you do.
Right.
Yeah, and this would be open to the public. We also plan on having it televised.
Oh, good.
So, and then that way it's streamed on the web also.
Okay. Anything else? No? Okay, oral communications number two, please.
Michelle Salmon, Brisbane resident. I have two issues that I want to bring up. One is that after taking the fencing survey, I wanted to reiterate my desire for us to have a parallel set of ordinances for the Northeast Ridge development that parallel what was set out in the original HCP that is supposed to be covered by the CCNRs, but the CCNRs are ineffective, in particular about fences and all the other issues that should be covered by the CCNRs, are in the CCNRs, but are not being enforced, that are unique to the permission that was given for that development to exist. And one of them is open fencing for insect and butterfly fly through. One of them is, you know, about the topography there and not being allowed to like change the shape of your yard and all of those things. And so I don't want the council to like just, you know, brush that by. I really want a parallel set of ordinances, especially since you've approved the remainder of the development, that so that we are protected and that the environment up there is protected as best as we can under the circumstances. And it's obvious to me that the Homeowners Association is not able to self-regulate those. And I think it's obvious to the city as well. I mean, our own city attorney and staff have spent a lot of time over one stupid fence that shouldn't be there. And the only way to have some teeth in it is to have a set of ordinances that parallel what should have been ordinances in the first place. So that's one issue that I want to bring up, and I hope that you will take that seriously, because I will continue to bring it up till hell freezes over, because it really needs to be done, and we have a responsibility, and that responsibility is not being met. The other issue that I'd like to bring up that is of grave concern as well is the increasing amount of off-road bike and mini bike traffic on the slopes of San Bruno Mountain. And the city manager is well aware of this as his position as a trustee for the HCP. It's a somewhat jurisdictional issue because these mini bikes and bicycles are crossing Brisbane territory, kids driving these things at night without helmets or lights, and then they cross fish and game territory and county park territory. There are now tracks up into Buckeye Canyon and Owl Canyon. There's a whole lot of tracks taking off from the schoolyard at Littman School, tearing up that hillside now. These tracks cause extreme erosion. It's also dangerous for the people that are doing it. And it broke my heart. Here's a set of tracks right through a lupin plant that we know hosts Mission Blue because we've photographed them on that plant. We've photographed their They're young, they're larvae on that plant, and here's a tire track right through it, all the way up close to the shell mound in Buckeye Canyon. So I don't know what we can do, in particular as a city and as an entity and as a part of the trustees for the HCP, to stop this and to patrol this area and to keep these unwanted bicycles and motorbikes and illegal mini bikes off of the mountain. They're not allowed there. They shouldn't be there, and they're tearing up the habitat. One bike can do a tremendous amount of damage. I have photographs. You can see the tire tracks right through the lupins and the other host plants, and it's egregious. And I would like the city to support a citywide campaign of awareness to parents of children that are out doing this and to other young adults that might be riding their bikes up there off-road. It's not an off-road area. And anything else we can do to work multi-jurisdictionally to prevent this further damage to the mountain, to our precious resources. So I hope you take that seriously, too. If you go up and look, it'll make you sick, just sick. And the area above the school is also part of the HCP, and that's being torn up and eroded also by off-road bikes. So I just wanted to make you very aware of it. I know that the city manager is aware of it. I don't know what other city staff is aware of it, and I don't know what recourse we have, but we need to do something. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. I was on San Bruno Mountain over the weekend, yeah, and I saw those tire tracks. Actually, I ran into Ken, and what do you do? I mean, I think having something perhaps in the blog or the newsletter that, this states that case of why you should not do it, and then also identifying what the fine is if you are caught doing that. I mean, I think enforcing it would be difficult, but I think if people are aware of it, they might think twice, or a mother or a father might tell their child, okay, you know what, I know that you're going up there with your bike, you really shouldn't do that because these are the reasons, if staff could do some kind of awareness to the community, that'd be great.
If you could relay that to the chief. And maybe she can get some help from the SO again. They've got dirt bikers, and they can go up there and start citing or slap them on the wrist and send them home.
Mr. Mayor, could staff...
Would you mind? Yeah, I'm sorry.
I think there's a few issues that we probably ought to brief you on, because it's not necessarily a police issue, but Stuart can respond.
So we do have an article coming out in the next city publication about this.
Okay.
We have signs that we are working with the state fish and game to have the right wording, so we can post signs on our trails to let people know that, I mean, it's not just the bikes, but also dogs off leash also cause problem habitat. So we've worked with fish and game to get the right kind of signage. We worked with the Park, Beach, and Recreation Commission to figure out where to place them and what they should look like. So we are working to try and get that education part out, and if there's other ideas, and we will get it out on the blog. So if there's other ideas, maybe trying also hearing is putting maybe something out in the Thursday packet through the schools.
Yes,
might help as a way to get the word out. So we are looking to get the word out to let people know that this is endangers the environment and it doesn't preserve it for future generations. I think that's the big concern, is that you might be enjoying yourself today, but other people won't have the same enjoyment in the future, and we will be damaging the ecosystem. So we are getting that out as quickly as we can. So we appreciate it letting us know, because I don't bike off road. I don't see the tire tracks.
And I think that's fine. That's great that you're taking a proactive approach to it. But the bottom line is that these may not all be Brisbane residents. We've always got to keep that one in hand. And the only way you're going to stop those is by having a SO biker up there and cite a couple if he has to, or slap them on the wrist and send them home. So let's not rule that one out completely. But it's up to the city manager. We'll let him have it again. He hasn't got enough to do.
Getting the schools involved, letting the superintendent know Thursday packet is also helpful.
Okay, we're through with oral communications. The only item left is adjournment.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Let the record show it's 9:56.